He arrived by Cunarder with the recording apparatus, intending to stay a few months. In fact, he stayed for the rest of his life and made his home in London. And he was the friend of every great musician imaginable. Hardly anybody you can think of that he didn't know intimately. Paderewski, Rachmaninoff, Kreisler, Elgar. I mean, infinite, really, in the numbers. The struggles they had in the early days. But it all spread very quickly. By 1902, he'd found Caruso in Milan, was enormously impressed. And he went to record another famous tenor called Bonci. And he telegraphed back home for permission to record Caruso, not Bonci. Well, nobody'd heard of Caruso, so they told him to go ahead and do what he'd been sent to do. And but he heard a second performance of the Scala and was more than ever impressed, engaged Caruso on his own, paid him £100 in gold sovereigns for 10 songs, which he did in one afternoon, I think. Came back and they found they'd got, of course, a world-famous voice. Nothing did so much to put the gramophone on the map as Caruso.
We have one of the old acoustic recording machines, which we think dates from about 1911. And on the turntable is the large wax blank into which the recording had to be cut. The artist had to stand in front of the horn and project his voice into it. And on loud notes or high notes, it was necessary to move back away from the horn, and on softer notes to move nearer to it, so that there was sufficient force behind the voice to make the stylus cut its track into the wax. Now, on May the 11th, 1910, Nellie Melba, after a long day recording, made a special test record, the object of which was to decide the best position for Melba to stand in front of the recording horn. As the recording was taking place, she moved back to preset distances away from the horn.
The recording horn was fixed, and it meant that the performers had to crowd round it, and if it was a single singer with a piano accompanist, they were really in trouble because the piano could not be made to sound natural as it stood. So they had to put it on a packing case or a table or something of that sort, with its keyboard level with the soloist's ear and with the mouth of the recording horn and with the back taken off. and only then could they get it to sound anything like a piano. The operatic actresses and actors would go through their act as if they were on the stage and completely forget all about the instructions they'd been given. And so they had to be motioned backwards and forwards by people who could read the score. And sometimes it became very embarrassing because they would completely forget, as I said, and would have to be pulled back. And one operatic singer greatly took exception to this and smacked the engineer's face when he tried to pull her back. So they put her on a rubber-tired trolley and pulled her backwards and forwards while she was singing.
Basically, the physically larger that a gramophone horn is, and this, of course, is a completely acoustic machine, the larger the horn is, the more volume you get, and then the material from which the horn is made gives you the tone. So a small tin horn is small and tinny, and a large wooden horn makes quite a lot of volume and is mellow in tone. If it was too loud, there's a very easy answer, and that is that you literally, physically, put a sock in it. And that's the origin of the expression, of course. As far as the company was concerned, if you intended a loud or soft reproduction, you used needles of different sizes. Soft tone, which were thin strips of metal, and loud tone, which were big, chunky, thick needles.
The gramophone became accepted, I think, as a national favourite piece of furniture sometime during the Edwardian era, with the large external horns. But the strange thing was that around 1905 or 1906, Edwardian housewives decided they didn't like these things in their drawing rooms, and so the manufacturers had to devise a new kind of machine which would give the same results but without the external horn, which was considered so ugly. And so they enclosed it in a cabinet with a closed lid over the turntable and the disc and the sound box, as they called it then. For a long time, that was the main piece of furniture which you showed off with pride to your visitors as a sign of culture.
It's a long, long way to Tipperary. but my heart right there. It's a long way.
Well, the gramophone during the First World War, of course, became enormously popular as a morale booster with the servicemen, particularly in the trenches. And I've read many stories of the certain thing that they would always take would be the gramophone and supply of records. And knowing how heavy both were in those days, it must have added to their difficulties of transport enormously. They would no more think of abandoning their gramophone than they would abandon a machine gun post.
Take me back to dear old Limerick, but beyond the great London town.
As far as we're concerned, any kind of entertainment was very acceptable if the enemy allowed us that little bit of peace which we got now and again. It was really heartening to think that you could enjoy a few minutes, perhaps a bit more if the Germans let us, of real good old-time music.
Another little drink wouldn't do us any harm.
You shook up all your memories of home and how you left it, just like that.
Oh, we don't want to lose you, but we think you so dear for your king and your country. Don't need you so, we shall want you and miss you, but with our eyes and pain, we shall cheer you, thank you.
The machine was brought into Trafalgar Square and records were played on.